Hi, HRN listeners. We're celebrating our 15th anniversary, and we have a really fun campaign and an ask for you. This 15th anniversary tour is aiming to bring you closer to unique food and music experiences in some of the most exciting cities in America. All the while, we're raising funds to support our work empowering the next generation of food system storytellers through our fellowship programs. Here's how it works. Donate to HRN and be entered into a raffle in the city of your choice to win a dinner for two at a noteworthy restaurant and tickets for two to a concert at a prominent local venue. We have incredible partners in New York, Los Angeles, Philadelphia, Nashville, Las Vegas, Charleston, Asheville, and Ardmore, Pennsylvania, who have donated a meal for two and two tickets to a concert of the winner's choice. And all donations help fund our fellowship programs, where we're helping to build essential workforce readiness skills and food system storytelling skills. Check out heritageradionetwork.org/15 to donate and enter to win today. That's heritageradionetwork.org/15. Thank you.
Broadcasting live from Roberta's in Bushwick, Brooklyn, you're listening to heritageradionetwork.com.
Right? That's pretty good. What is Roberta's?
We make food.
All right.
What do you do?
Make radio.
Barely. This week's episode of Mike and Judy... Sponsored by Roberta's. It's sponsored by Roberta's.
Hello, Mr. and Mrs. America, from border to border, coast to coast, and all the ships at sea. Streaming live from the County of Kings, Brooklyn, New York City, on the Heritage Radio Network. Are you ready for the fastest half hour on the internet today? It's the Mike and Judy Show, spanning the globe for high-minded hijinks and lowbrow kicks to bring you the best in sex, drugs, rock and roll, and nuclear fission. They're too bad for radio and too good-looking for television. And now, here they are, to pluck the low-hanging fruit of the literati, your hosts, Mike Edison and Judy McGuire.
And we're back. And yes, I can hear myself. Hey, Mike, Happy New Year.
Happy New Year once again, Judy. I am so happy to be back here. I love the new sponsor drop from Roberta's.
Oh, my. It just makes me want to eat pizza.
It makes me want to drop Quaaludes, which is apparently the technique used to record such a fine sponsor drop. We're so fortunate to be here back at Roberta's in Bushwick here on the Heritage Radio Network.
Looking out at the lovely patrons of Roberta's. Mike, yeah.
Yeah.
Anyway, this week's show is about gentrification and changing New York, and Mike and I are going to have
a jello fight about it.
Apparently,
I just want to say right up front that I find that the people who are most against change are the ones who've done the least to affect it.
Okay. The ones who are most for rent stabilized apartments disappearing are generally those who own their own apartments or pay market rent.
I'm not against it, but I do pay market rent like most people do. And yeah, I mean, you have a rent stabilized place.
Yes, I do.
And it's a blessing.
It is a blessing. I feel very lucky. I have a cute apartment in Williamsburg where I would never be able to afford to live now because the rents are like $3,000 a month.
How long have you been in Williamsburg now?
Like 16 years.
Right. And what did it look like when you moved in?
It wasn't like a dump or anything, but there was nowhere to get sushi. Imagine that. There was like one Thai restaurant. We used to be able to say like, oh, meet me at the new bar, because there was only like one bar opening a year, and so everyone would know. But now it's like, now we just have a new bar on our corner. We have condos everywhere. People walking around with baby strollers that cost more than any car I've ever
owned.
Even
the strollers have strollers in Williamsburg.
There's nannies. There's gay dads, which is like the real marker of an upscale neighborhood.
I wish gay dads would move into my neighborhood. I live in the tony little hamlet of Kipps Bay, 28th Street, right? What do you say? Oh, you live around the fucking corner.
Well, we should introduce our guest.
But I thought Kevin Hine, former art director of Screw Magazine and famed New York historian. Kevin, you know, we live around the corner. I thought our neighborhood was going to turn gay.
Right.
And I was very excited when
I was hoping for it.
It's just frat.
Oh, my God.
I know. It went frat.
The PFAs. Completely. The post-frat assholes who I thought Gramercy would go north or Chelsea would come east and Murray Hill went south, and right. I'm fucked.
Right.
Yeah, I mean, but hey, you have like several choices, several dozen choices about where to watch the big game today.
I know. All the bars, all the great bars have giant TV screens in them now.
All great bars.
That's not a great bar.
No, it's not. I fucking hate TVs in bars and restaurants.
I know. It's really horrible.
But anyway, our other guest is Ed Hamilton, who lives at the Chelsea Hotel and has a blog about it, Living with Legends. And you can find that at legends.typepad.com. And he wrote a book called Legends of the Chelsea Hotel. Welcome to our show, Ed.
Thanks, Judy.
Now, you guys have been going through some real shit lately. The building is being torn apart. No new guests are allowed in.
Let me tell you something. If Patti Smith came to my house and wanted to sing, I'd be pretty pissed off, too.
Well, let's not get into a Patti Smith fight.
It would be great if we had invited her to come to our house.
Whatever. But, she made three good records 30 years ago.
Who cares? Yeah, she wanted to come as a kind of a liberator and, you know, and save us from...
Right.
You know, from these developers, but she appeared to be working for them. So.
Yeah, she played for the developer and the architects and all their rich friends who are trying to get people like you out.
She is one confused kitten, that Patti Smith.
I had a theory that I shared with Cheryl Tippins, who's writing a history of the Chelsea Hotel. I think she has the Jersey girl inferiority thing, which I feel I can speak to because I am a Jersey girl.
Yeah, but you're from like fucking Camden or something, right?
Yeah, whatever. You're like the from the state that is a joke, and you get
it's the murder capital of the world, Camden.
Yeah,
I guess there's got to be some pride there. We are number one.
But I think she's wanted to be like, you know, she's written for Vogue and stuff. I think she's one of these like punks who
Patty.
Yeah.
She won the National fucking Book Award.
Her book was great.
Okay, I have not read it, and I swear...
What did you think of her book, Ed?
Well, I read one chapter of it, and I thought that was pretty good. I read the excerpt that was in Rolling Stones. I thought it wasn't bad.
I loved the book. Did you read it, Kevin?
No, I didn't. No, I have not read the book.
You know what? More people have told me to read that fucking book than have asked me to join LinkedIn. And my reaction is pretty much the same. I want to break the fucking rules.
Well,
I think it's a gimme. You know, I'm sorry. I'm cynical about Patty. I mean, I was a total fan. Easter, great record, and the record before that, Horses. You know, fantastic records. And that's pretty much what her reputation lies on.
But
you know,
it doesn't mean that her book sucks.
She's like this art darling and this darling of the Bohemia, and it just seems she's such a darling. You know, when I say I don't like the Beatles, people, you know, freak out and they get violent with me. But when I say I don't like Patti Smith, it's like they throw fucking Molotovs through my windows. It's like she is the ultimate sacred cow in rock and roll.
I disagree. I wasn't like a huge fan, but loved the book. And I think you can't really critique a book until you've read it.
I said first thing I said is I haven't read it, so I'm not speaking that. I'm very cynical about Patty and this whole kerfuffle, to use your favorite word, Ms. McGuire.
I love that word.
Kerfuffle's an excellent word.
Yeah, a lot of people think it's an over romanticized account of that era. You know,
that's okay.
That's the kind of criticisms that I've got from around the hotel of people who really lived there and knew her at the time.
And that's okay.
But, yeah, but it's okay with me.
I'm
too.
The only one who read the damn book here. So I will, you know, anyway.
I think the whole thing is over-romanticized. And this is part of my problem with, you know, I mean, the Chelsea Hotel is it's a house full of ghosts. I mean, do we really need, like you were saying before, Herbert Hunky's room? Oh, they're going to destroy it. The guy was a junkie and a thief, and they're going to destroy his room. Should it be held up as some sort of shrine?
Well, it's not only his room. I mean, it's Thomas Wolfe's room, Arthur Miller's room.
Madonna's
room. William Burroughs'
room.
Yeah, Madonna's room.
Oh, yeah, really. I mean, so what am I supposed to do with all these rooms?
The list goes on and on. Well, you know, that's a part of the Chelsea Hotel that's so great, is you can go there and get inspiration because you're staying in the same room as Bob Dylan, or you're staying in the same room as Dylan Thomas, or whoever, you know. I mean, the list goes on and on. And that's, you know, that's what these new developers don't seem to understand, is that you can't just cut it up into cookie-cutter boxes and then have the same authenticity as before. It's just going to be like, you know, like a theme hotel or something like that.
Yeah, it's kind of now. It's kind of like Disneyland for junky romance.
I wouldn't say that. I would say that, you know, it was very authentic until, you know, the past few years. I mean, you know, it wasn't as run down and torn up as people make it out to be. It was just that, you know, they preserved, you know, the moldings and the old doors and the old fixtures and stuff, instead of just tearing them down and throwing them out, like is what
they're, is what they did.
What they're doing right now.
So you've been there about 15 years now, right?
The art was literally on the walls, you know, of the people who had lived there over the years. So it was like a living historical document of the past. I mean, that was what made it so grand and beautiful. And, you know, they took that art and threw it in the back of a rental van and carted it off to God knows where. I mean, and some of it actually belonged to people.
Yeah, like the Larry Rivers piece. His people are fighting.
Yeah, they're fighting for that. I mean,
Larry Rivers, the child molester? That Larry Rivers?
Philip Taff had a piece up on the wall. Joe Ando, I mean, Donald Batchelor, these are well-known artists, and their works worth in the hundreds of thousands of dollars, and they had just loaned it to the hotel, and now they carted it off. Yeah,
weren't you assaulted by workers there?
I was assaulted by workers. My friend Arthur Nash was leading a tour of union reps through the building. Excuse me.
Because they're using non-union workers.
Because they're using non-union workers. They're using illegal aliens and ex-cons and people like that, you know, making as little as $8 an hour. And so the place was filled with asbestos and lead dust. And so my friend Arthur was leading a tour, and, the non-union foreman, he decided that he didn't like that. And, you know, so he kind of sicked his workers on Arthur. And this was like in the building itself, and you know they assaulted Arthur in the building, and then so he had to flee the building, and that was where I came into it. And you know when he came out the building, I was with him at the time, and they basically chased him all the way down to 7th Avenue, where I got in the middle of it, and they assaulted both of us like right out in the middle of 7th Avenue with with traffic held up. At the time.
I can't approve of that gentrification, Mike.
I don't approve of that either. And these are the evil... I mean, this is like, Shane, the evil railroaders versus the homesteaders with Jack Palance coming in and destroying the art and chasing you down 7th Avenue. No, I'm not with that. What I do question, though, is this blind reverence for the past and this complete resistance to change that I often hear. Not just the Chelsea, but... You know, CBGBs, and we're talking about that before. People were so sad to see CBGBs go, including me. I loved it there.
Enjoyed
playing there.
Well, it's like a piece of your youth disappears.
And New York changes.
So you like Barbatos better than that.
Are you kidding that fucker? All I need is a $500 fucking
sweater. The rule is that if they destroy something, they're always going to put something worse in its place.
Well, that shouldn't be the case. Unfortunately, developers have shitty taste.
Because the bottom line is money.
They know that if they put something nice... Then there'll be people 10 years from now who say, well, you can't tear that down.
But the bottom line has always been money in New York City. That hasn't changed in the 60s and the 50s and the turn of the century. And I don't like where it's going now either because people have bad fucking taste. You know, I don't dig where CBGB is. And what's even more onerous, if you walk down Bowery lately, a couple blocks down, there's some restaurants called DBGB.
Daniel Blue's
there.
It's like ersatz, like appropriation of the logo type to try to give the Bowery some authenticity next to... American apparel and whatever the fuck is over there.
7-Eleven is there now, too.
Jesus, that's 7-Eleven pisses me off more than anything. There's one on my fucking corner. If I wanted to live next to a truck stop, I'd drive a fucking truck. You know?
Does that piss you off more than Kmart?
That pisses me off more than a lot of things. 7-Eleven pisses me off more than the closing of the Mars Bar.
I don't care that the Mars Bar closed.
You hated the Mars Bar. Why?
I always felt like I was going to get herpes in there. That's part of the
appeal.
Okay, you know what? Once I turned 30, I needed to be able to urinate in the bar that I was going to drink in. Okay. And there's no going to the bathroom in the Mars Bar. I know people who had sex in the Mars Bar bathroom, and that actually grosses me out more than anything else.
The concept of having sex in the Mars Bar bathroom?
Like, I didn't even like drinking from the glasses there.
Coming from the author of How Not to Date,
just go there and spend about 15 minutes. That's what it's good for.
The alcohol killed the germs. I spent many nights there.
You're just slumming in this extreme, low-life culture or whatever.
Well,
and that's kind of fun,
too. And the same can be said about so many of these other places that, we hold in all this reverence. I thought the Mars Bar was the last great real punk rock dive in New York. On the same hand, it was a filth pit. And the ratio of times I've been there to the times I've seen fights break out there is exactly 1-to-1. I figure this out. I mean, it was that kind of place.
Yeah.
I mean, it was horrifying. Yet I loved it. And yet I don't miss it at all.
One thing we should point out is our friend Richard Manitoba. It's Manitoba's 15-year anniversary today of the bar.
Yeah.
Really?
Yay. So
good does come. Good things do come to the East Village.
Yeah, see, things can change and be good. Yeah.
You got some good memories of the Chelsea Hotel. You were telling me before about these crazy parties.
Well, yeah. I mean, it was a place to go if you wanted to, if your apartment was small, you'd get some people together, and then you'd have a party in one of the rooms. It was, You know, I'm sure you don't like hearing about that, but you'd have
I've heard about 100 parties, people
show up, and you know, everyone would chip in for the overnight rent, and then there'd be like a circus train of people coming through the lobby, and they'd let them go. They'd say, "Where are you going? 309?" And phew, dozens of people could party in there.
That was part of it. Yeah, I mean, besides the permanent residents, there's also the transient residents who just came. Yeah. And rented a space, and that, you know, that was all due to Stanley Bard, you know, who was the proprietor for 50 years.
Uh-huh.
And it's, you know, it's a shame. I mean, poor Stanley's, he's sick now, so I don't know what's happening with him. But it was a shame that his son wasn't allowed to come back in charge of the hotel, which is what he'd planned all along. And then he obviously would have continued it in the same vein.
Mm-hmm. But so many like that, the Gramercy Park Hotel was always a favorite of mine because I've interviewed so many fun musicians there, like Mojo Nixon, Shane McGowan. It used to be the place for musicians to go, and they had a great little bar. And now I probably can't even afford a drink there. But I'm sure if I had to pee, it would be a delightful experience.
On that note, why don't we take a quick break?
With Rufus Wainwright doing a cover of the Leonard Cohen hit about getting a beach from Janis Joplin. Yes.
Rufus Wainwright does a wonderful job of it.
I remember you well at the Chelsea Hotel. You were talking so brave and so sweet, giving me head on the unmade bed while the limousine's waiting. Those were the reasons. That was New York. We were running for the money and the flesh. That was called love for the workers in song. Probably still is for those of them left.
Love that version even more than the Leonard Cohen version.
Welcome to the Heroin Hotel.
I know. I was telling these guys during the break that I tried to find a peppy Chelsea Hotel song, and there's really not one.
You know, the place has an aura of smack around it. I mean, that's kind of unfortunate. It's the kind of thing, though, that I don't know how romantic, you know, all this junky love is. And this is coming from a guy, you know, me, loves William Burroughs and loves many of the people who live there.
Yeah, it's
my own personal experience with heroin is very limited for a good goddamn reason.
It's only romantic in theory, and that's like kind of in my book I get into that too. That, you know, like junkies shot up in my bathroom in the 90s, and you know, there's like a whole story about how I tried to keep them out by changing the lock, and you know, they would come they come in late at night, and they would actually bust the lock off the door so that, you know, like I had, you know, so like almost daily or at least weekly, you know, I had to go downstairs to the desk and try to get them to put a new lock on the door.
Well, this begs the question, why would you want to live in such a place?
Yeah, it's better in theory than in practice sometimes. I mean, it's like, you know, everything has its downside. And then I guess I'm exaggerating it in a way, you know, too, for like comic effect in my book. But yeah, there were some problems. There were also prostitutes who came and lived in the room next to us. And you know, while that sounds good in theory, they shared my bathroom, and they, you know, they had a habit of hanging their underwear all around the bathroom. And since there were, you know, four of them in there, like the other three would hang out in the bathroom while the one, you know, serviced to John. So, you know,
that's, and you shared this bathroom?
I did share this bathroom. Yeah,
never a dull moment over at the.
they only came once in a while. Like flitted around to different rooms in the hotel so as to give, you know, people a break.
Yeah. Well, that was conscientious. So what is it like living there? Do you have an apartment? Do you still share a bathroom? I mean,
we do still share a bathroom. My wife and I live in a room that's about 220 square feet,
uh-huh.
and we share a bathroom with now one other room. There were at one time four rooms.
Wow.
that were on the bathroom, and it's Herbert Hunky's bathroom, by the way. His old bathroom. He died in 1995, which was like the year before we moved, up to our room.
Oh, so you never met him.
You knew Herbert Hunky.
Yeah, I used to edit him at High Times. He would write for us sometimes, and he was like, I know he was a junkie, but he was like a charming old dude. He would always put, you always knew at the end of the conversation he would be asking you for money.
The touch.
But he was so good at putting on the touch that you were like, okay, you know what? This conversation was worth $5, even though I'm only making $20,000. he was just a wealth of history and just so charming and really just a great talker. I mean, just such a good...
Well, there's been no shortage of charming junkies. I mean, the vast majority of them are quite the opposite. But the ones we celebrate are certainly charming. William Burroughs, and as I was saying earlier today in our pre-show prep, and yes, folks, we actually do that. I think the Rolling Stones started to suck after Keith Richards cleaned up. I mean, that was sort of the demarcation line.
I mean, is Keith Richards really cleaned up? I mean, is he really cleaned up? Maybe he doesn't shoot smack anymore, but he's still a drunk.
Well, if that's the yardstick by which I'm measuring this. Well, once a junkie, always a junkie, Judy.
Yeah, they always clean up. Yeah, they always say they're cleaned up. They're never at present a junkie.
Yeah, they're always ex-junkies.
Well, Keith's off the spike, but incredibly well-preserved for a guy who's lived like he has.
But, I mean, all these guys, they live forever, these junkies. Herbert Hunky was really old. Burroughs was really old. If you have enough money, you can... live to be a really
well, you know,
junkie.
Keith Richards' secret was do good junk, don't do bad drugs. He stayed off the street drugs and bought. But when you're in the Rolling Stones, you get to do that.
Yeah, you have shoppers.
Sid Vicious, not so much.
Yeah, there's
a little Chelsea Hotel story that didn't end so well.
The Sid Vicious story. yeah. I lived there when punks and goth kids used to come by and burn candles outside. Sid's old door and, carve their initials in his door and
stuff.
But
didn't they combine the room or break it up somehow so it wouldn't be the same room that she died in?
Yeah, they did. They did at one point. Uh-huh. Yeah, and they changed the number.
Right.
So they spread it around between, two different rooms.
So have you actually ever seen a ghost?
I was just
going to
ask that.
Ooh.
No, I have not.
We're like Fox and Mulder over here.
You've never seen one? I bet there's tons. I've seen ghosts before, really? But not
I saw Patty in there once, and she was kind of ghostly.
Same thing.
This was when she came back to the hotel in the 90s after after her husband died.
Right.
And I saw her really late, and at 3 o'clock in the morning or something, just kind of flitting down the stairs, looking at art and such, and that was about.
You ever see my career in there? Because that's kind of like a ghost too.
Oh, stop. You're co-host of the Mike and Judy Show. What more do you want? It's like being Regis.
Wow. It's being Regis.
That means I get to be that perky Kelly Ripa.
I'll tell you what I do miss in the landscape of New York. I miss doing Screw magazine.
I know.
Right? Don't you miss doing Screw?
And now we have the Republican primary.
This is your time.
There's gold in those darn hills.
I know.
You'd be bending them over and fucking...
The Santorum frothy mix.
I'm still trying to make Hey Rick Suck My Dick, hashtag Hey Rick Suck My Dick trend on Twitter. So please get with me. That's the former lobbyist for the WWF, now WWE, Rick Santorum, who was... Yeah, he worked for the WWE, one of their lawyers out there in PA. Whatever,
So you think it's going to be Mitt and Obama?
Do I think it's going to be
Mitt? No way are they going to let a Mormon win the primary.
Have you seen his play, The Book of Mormon? It's offensive. But I think most Americans would agree. I think that's the card you got to play. If Mitt Romney becomes the candidate, they got to start showing people that Book of Mormon shit because, it's pretty wacky.
And it's more wacky than most religions. Yes.
I'm talking about the play.
Oh, the play. Okay. I just blame it on him.
Blame it on him.
So, Ed, what are the plans for the hotel? What do they want to do with it?
Well, I think they still want to turn it into a kind of boutique hotel, like a theme hotel.
Right.
And now they're they've got this new group called King and Grove, which is all Ed Sheets's group. Who are coming in, and I think they want to continue, the artsy theme or whatever. They were the ones that I guess that got Patti Smith to play at Chelsea. And so, I mean, they've got a guy called Gene Kaufman who's the architect, and he's famous for being the architect of Holiday Inns and places like that. So
he's really tasteful and has great taste.
So they're going to put in $5 million condos.
Holiday Inn was good enough for Led Zeppelin and the Who.
It's still too early to see.
That's what they did with the Gramercy.
I've seen what they've done. First they gutted all the interior walls that they could get their hands on, and they've started to rebuild with just putting up this tacky metal stuff, which I guess they're going to hang sheetrock on and make really thin walls. And every once in a while I can catch a glimpse in this one wing that they're doing like that. So as far as an architectural point of view, I guess that's what they're going to do. But they're trying to evict all of us. They've got 30 tenants in court right now.
Are you in court?
Yeah, I'm in court right now.
Yeah, I had to fight with my landlady too. Did you see the Lost Bohemia, that movie about the Carnegie Towers?
I didn't see that, but I remember the issue. Yeah, they finally got them all out, didn't they?
And they turned it into a cubicle farm.
Which is the crime. But also, I got to say in here, I know you hate it when I remind everybody of this, those people did not get thrown out on the street. They were put into fabulous luxury apartments.
But
on
you're
Central
evicting
Park.
A 99-year-old woman. Like that. Just let her die there. How long is she going to live?
You know, I don't disagree on one level. On the other level, things are going to change and developers are going to come in, and they're not all played by Jack Palance. Let me ask you this. Is it possible to develop New York without us liberal punk rockers that we are hating every fucking inch of it? I mean, it's one example.
Nobody's chosen to do it yet.
I think they did a great job with MoMA. It's the last good thing I saw. Done in New York, and boy, remember how terrified I was going to fuck it up,
They did a fucking good job on it, man. They
nailed it, if you ask me. Right. I love the new MoMA, right. And that was like everybody, no, we're going to lose the old MoMA, but they made more space, they kept the right signature riff of the helicopter when you walk in, they somehow managed to, postmodern architecture is not something I'm necessarily fond of, on a bad day, give me a roll of tinfoil and I can do Frank Gehry for you just fine, but I think with MoMA, they really figured out how to put a glass building in that old neighborhood and have it really capture both the neighborhood and the spirit of the art inside. Unfortunately, that's a fucking rarity.
Oh, yeah. And it's the museum itself doing it. I mean,
I would love to see
them. They've got money. They didn't do it the cheap way, which is the way most new housing is built in New York. It's built for shit. My friend just bought a condo. It's leaking already.
I hear that all the time, that those new boxes going up.
Oh, man.
They're terrible.
Well, that's always the fucking case. I mean, contracting and construction has got to be the most corrupt business in the United States of America, and cutting corners and paying off regulators and licensors. I mean, my understanding is that's why that BP oil rig fell apart, is because, they set it up and they're not checking things and they're moving in there before the cement dries. How long it takes for cement to dry?
Well,
like a month.
50 years.
The regulators are corrupt, too. I mean, if you try to get the DOB or the HPD or anybody like that involved, I mean, it's just like pulling teeth. I mean, they'll come and inspect the building and if they don't find something, then
they
go away. And like a body. I mean, it's impossible to get them to enforce the laws. And even when they do, it's
for a day. They'll put a stop work
or something.
Yeah, I mean, it's much more financially lucrative to hire somebody shitty and non-union to do it and just keep paying the fines. And they were building a condo next to me, which had to go rental because there weren't enough rich people to fill it. And they almost took down our building, destroying the building next door in the process, because this woman, Marie Grasso, has about a million complaints against her, and yet she's still allowed to keep practicing with the DOB's blessing in New York.
Yeah, what you have to have is somebody a couple of people who are just really dedicated and devote their whole lives, to preserving your building or whatever. That's it. That's the only way that anybody has any success. And luckily, we have that. We have a few people, like maybe five people, who are really dedicated to the struggle in the Chelsea Hotel and, just devote a lot of time to it.
So where do you think you're going to be a year from now, Ed?
Well, that's hard to say. I mean, I don't think that they're going to be able to evict as many people as they think they are through the courts, and I think they're going to have to buy people out. I mean, it depends on what they're allowed to do. They're going to have to they know they're going to have to go forward really quick, you know, in order to, you know, make a profit on their investment or whatever. So I think they're going to have to try to be buying people out. They're not going to get me out easily. I can tell you that right now. And there's several people like us, and, you know, and we're not going to go along, you know, with their plans, you know, to turn it into a boutique hotel. So they'll have to get rid of me through the courts, and they've got me in court on the 27th. So, you know, maybe they'll succeed. I don't think they will unless they, you know.
Is it expensive to live at the Chelsea Hotel?
In terms of rent, well, my rent's $1,100 a month. You know, I mean, that's not that inexpensive.
Especially not for a shared bed.
I've got an SRO room. Right. Yeah, I mean, how much are you going to expect to pay for that? But, you know, that, I mean, of course they want to jack it up and want me to charge, you know, want to charge me more, and, you know, that's what it's over now. You know, they gave me an illegal overcharge, and so now they're claiming I owe money. So
yeah, they do play dirty. There is nothing more ugly in the history of New York City than tenant landlord litigation. That is fucking ugly business, man.
I have a really mean lawyer.
That's good. Jew? A Jew?
I don't know.
Get one. Okay. Check.
I will check.
Okay. It's not Bernstein, Weiss.
Guralnik.
Guralnik. Yeah, it could be Jewish. Okay.
Could be Jewish.
Mean. Yeah, you need a fucking pit bull, man, because they will come at you with guns blazing, loaded for fucking bear. It is the fucking worst, that LMT litigation.
Well, I mean, we're going to go now, and hopefully Ed will keep his room at the Chelsea Hotel.
Okay, occupy the Chelsea Hotel.
And we're going to leave with
another happy song?
Another upbeat song
about the Chelsea Hotel. All right, once again, it's the Mike and Judy Show from Roberta's here in Bushwick on the Heritage Radio Network in Bushwick, where the rents are not $1,100 a month. Thank you, guys. Thank you, Ed. Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Judy. This is Mike Edison. See you guys later.
Thank you.
Bye.
Wrapped up in foil, you wonder if she can uncall. Come now, see them run now, here they come now, Chelsea girls, here's room 115, filled with...
Thanks for listening to this program on the Heritage Radio Network. You can find all of our archived programs on heritageradionetwork.com, as well as a schedule of upcoming live shows. You can also podcast all of our programs on iTunes by searching Heritage Radio Network in the iTunes Store. You can find us on Facebook and follow us on Twitter for up-to-date news and information. Thanks for listening.
Hey there, I'm Lee Ullman here with some big news from the National Young Farmers Coalition. We're partnering with Heritage Radio Network on a special season of The Farm Report. It's all about what's happening with the Farm Bill and how it impacts farmers and eaters.
I am growing diversified vegetables on land that's been in our family for 150 years.
And so with the pandemic, gentrification, property values going up, we had to sell the land. And we lost it.
Join us as we uncover the untold stories behind this massive piece of legislation that shapes how we grow our food, what we eat, and so much more.
The problems we have had, those are things that come from earlier Farm Bill and USDA policy, right? Like Earl Butts, get big or get out.
You know, it's my responsibility to know not only what I'm eating, but then like how that all came to be. And realize, like, wow, like this piece of legislation, all this money, like, it's technically something that I support as a taxpayer.
While Congress debates the next farm bill, this is not just an invitation to listen. It's a call to action. Be part of the conversation. Subscribe to the Farm Report on Heritage Radio Network, wherever you listen to podcasts.